I'm echoing, so I do need my...
Yeah,
hey, I'm Lindsay from the Laurel Historical Society. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the executive director. This is the third in our series of The Rest of the Story. We're really excited. We know Richard always does a great job in the nice big notebook for the stuff he's going to tell you guys. So I'm not going to take too long other than to say Richard has been a great addition to the Historical Society. He just joined the board, I think officially. And he has been volunteering for our exhibits committee. So if you then see any of our last two exhibits, that was Richard's design work. Looks really great. We're very excited that he's helping us out in that way. But he's also a really great researcher, which is the whole reason for this presentation. And he's a great guy. I don't know, what else should I say about you, Richard?
Are you talking about me?
Yeah.
He's a great singer.
He's a great singer, and at the end of this program, he's going to sing.
That's why I didn't want that microphone there.
At the end of the program, I am going to come back up here, tell you a little bit about upcoming programs. I usually take about 30 seconds to do that, and I will beg you to fill out evaluations, which I will be handing out as Richard starts taking questions, which I assume he'll do at the end.
Sure.
So please don't be disturbed when I hand you a piece of paper, but please fill it out if you can. Thanks.
I am going to double check that we've got what we need. All right, is everybody dry? I noticed it just like decided to start downpouring right as we were getting started. I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight on a Thursday night, like right at dinner time or happy hour time, if you will. As Lindsay mentioned, this presentation is part of The Rest of the Story, a series based on Ripped from the Headlines, Laurel in the News, which is the current exhibit at the Laurel Museum. I want to thank the Laurel Historical Society for inviting me and the Laurel Police Department for hosting us. I'll be presenting the story of one of Laurel's most notorious cold cases, the murder of Stefanie Watson in 1982, and the bizarre, unlikely path to finding her killer 30 years later. My name is Richard Friend, and I created a nostalgia website and a book called Lost Laurel, which focuses on the businesses of Laurel's past, the stores and restaurants that have disappeared over the years. I've been doing this for about 5 years now, and collecting, documenting, and sharing little pieces of Laurel's retail history. It's usually lighthearted, virtual time travel through Laurel's pop culture. I try to stay away from things like crime and politics and other heavy topics. But in 2012, I realized that it had been almost 30 years since the Stefanie Watson murder, which was such a vivid memory for me growing up. It really struck me that nothing had been written about it after all these years, especially considering the circumstances. Here's this beautiful young woman who disappears on what was supposed to be her last night in Laurel before leaving town. Her bloodstained car is found a few days later, and a month later, part of her skull is found. There are no suspects, no motives, and no arrests. Her body is never recovered, and the case goes cold. In fact, because there was no information to be found about it online, I eventually had to call the police to find out that the case was indeed still open. I wanted to write something about it in the context of Lost Laurel. Like the Kennedy assassination or the Challenger explosion, it was a chance to get people to remember and talk about where they were when this horrible thing occurred. But at the same time, I hope to finally learn who Stefanie Watson actually was. I've often said that this case reads like a New York Times bestseller, and the story of how this all came about isn't much different in that regard. Like a classic tragedy, it played out in three acts: Stefanie's disappearance, the grisly discovery of her car, and the discovery of her partial remains. And I'll be relaying the story to you tonight in three parts: the crime itself as it unfolded in 1982, the unlikely theory I found myself developing in my own research 30 years later, and the even more unlikely arrest that was finally made the following year. I'll try to also give you a sense of who Stefanie really was, beyond just that photo on a missing persons flyer. Before we start, I want to say a few words about that flyer, which I learned was actually designed by Stefanie's coworkers at the Greater Laurel Beltsville Hospital. For most of us, sadly, it was the first we'd ever seen or heard of Stefanie Watson. And for the next 30 years, it seemed to be the only thing. At the start of my research, I couldn't find a single image of Stefanie, aside from the grainy 1982 coverage in the Laurel Leader, and even that was only available on microfilm. A big part of what motivated me to write about the case was the fact that virtually nothing had been written. There were no updates, no new leads, nothing. Our collective memory of Stefanie Watson was becoming as faded as this overly Xeroxed flyer. I wanted to at least try to bring her back into focus, back into Laurel's public consciousness 30 years later. This one's a lot clearer. This is one of the original flyers that's been in Stephanie's cold case file with the Prince George's County Police Department since 1982. I want to thank Lieutenant Shanae Waddy, Assistant Commander, Records Management Division, for tracking this down and scanning it for me. And thank you to Kevin Leonard for contacting Lieutenant Waddy on my behalf. This flyer is how most of Laurel was first introduced to Stephanie Watson 30 years ago. It, a lot of memories, and some important answers are finally starting to come into clear focus. Now, as we get into part one, I realize this is a pretty dark subject tonight, and this might be the only bit of comic relief you're gonna get. This was me in 1982 on the playgrounds at Stewart Manor Apartments where I grew up. Apparently, I was already practicing for the weekly drive back and forth from Centerville, Virginia to Laurel that I do all the time now. We good, Doug? Like most kids in the early 80s, I was a big comic book fan. And I was especially fascinated by these earn prizes or cash ads for the Olympic Sales Club that were always on the back cover. I don't know how many of you tried this, but it was actually a greeting card company, not a great one from what I remember. The idea was that for every item you sold, you could either keep a dollar or you could strive to earn one of these awesome prizes, which always looks so much better as these little illustrated thumbnails. A walkie-talkie set for 18 items, a black and white TV, of course, for like 50 items. For some reason, this is what I had to have, a handheld computer racing game. In hindsight, I'm seeing like a driving theme here. I'm surprised I didn't grow up to drive a taxi or something. But I will say this for it, it still works to this day. I'm still not any good at it, by the way. In addition to selling door to door in every building at Stewart Manor, I set up shop in front of Zaire's, which was right across the street at Laurel Plaza. It's the current site of the Second Avenue thrift store today, which is kind of strange seeing that parking lot filled again after all those years of being empty, which is a good thing. In 1982, Zaire's was a well-trafficked, safe store. And for the most part, I felt completely safe standing outside the entrance and asking approaching customers if they'd be interested in buying something from my catalog. I was there during the summer mornings and early afternoons when it was completely light out, but standing there alone could be a bit scary for a kid. I remember it feeling extremely isolated at times, especially in the hours before that huge parking lot would fill up. It was here in front of Zaire's that I first saw the missing persons flyer about Stephanie Watson. Waiting for potential customers, I couldn't help staring at it. I'd read it again and again, trying to imagine what could have possibly happened to this pretty lady, and at the same time, trying not to imagine what might have happened. It was also a particularly scary time for kids in this country. Just 1 year earlier, in the summer of 1981, 6-year-old Adam Walsh was abducted and murdered in Florida. He'd been standing in front of a Sears store for only a few minutes when he disappeared. His severed head was found in a Vero Beach canal 2 weeks later, and the rest of his body has never been found. The Adam Walsh case became global news. A movie was made, it prompted new legislation for child safety, and Adam's father, John Walsh, went on to become a well-known advocate for victims' rights and the host of America's Most Wanted. I'm not exaggerating when I say that I thought about Adam Walsh every time a stranger approached at Zaire's that summer. There were often long, lonely stretches of time, those summer mornings in front of Zaire's, when no customers would show. It seemed like it was just me and that flyer, just me and Stephanie Watson. Her photo on the flyer was comforting somehow. I'd look at it whenever I felt scared, and it was almost like she was watching over me protectively, saying, "Don't worry, you're going to be just fine." I walked to Zaire's from Stewart Manor nearly every day that August to do these sales, and Stephanie Watson's smiling face was always the first and last thing I saw there. As I'd leave each day to go back home, I remember wishing I could tell her the same thing. "You're gonna be just fine too." But somehow I had a feeling that just wasn't true. Like most Laurel kids in 1982, I first heard the details of the case in brief sanitized tidbits from my parents and from overly exaggerated rumors spread by other kids in my neighborhood. It was scary stuff, to be sure, even for adults. Rumors and speculation abounded in the days and weeks after she vanished on July 22, 1982. The general facts as I knew them at the time were stark and terribly grim. She had worked at the Greater Laurel Beltsville Hospital. Her car was found near Laurel Center Mall several days later, saturated with blood. And even more chilling, part of her skull was discovered over a month later in the woods at the dead end of Larchdale Road. I was too young to read this kind of stuff in the newspapers or listen to the news reports, but word spread fast throughout Laurel in the wake of Stephanie's disappearance. She'd gone missing on Thursday, July 22nd. Her car, a 1981 bronze Chevy Chevette, was found 4 days later on Monday, July 26th. It's actually in the Middletown high-rise in that shot. This obviously isn't Stephanie's actual Chevette. Her tires were muddy and clumps of weeds or brush were stuck in the driver's side door and grill as if the car had been driven off-road. And the interior was covered with blood. This photo is of Stephanie's car. This black and white photo actually ran in the Laurel Leader. The car had been found in the parking lot of the Middletown Apartments high-rise on 4th Street, just behind Laurel Center Mall. Visible in this photo, the search crews canvassing the area near Laurel Lake. Mayor Michaels, a resident of the Middletown Apartments, first noticed the Chevette when she unwittingly parked her car next to it. Her daughter, Elaine, remarked how dirty it was. The police activity in the parking lot drew a great deal of attention, especially being right across the street from the busy Laurel Center Mall. Countless residents and onlookers got a view they immediately regretted when they peeked inside the car. As the Leader reported, "Bless her heart," said one woman when she saw the condition of the car and wondered about the missing Watson's fate. "It's too late for prayers now." Audrey Presley, the older sister of my two best friends, was there that day with her mom. They saw the car. She was the first to tell us younger kids about what they'd seen. I can't remember her exact words, but it was enough to convince us that Stephanie wasn't going to be found alive. I also learned that my uncle, Art Baxley, actually knew Stephanie casually. They both worked at the hospital. He was on the cleaning crew, and she worked as the night admissions clerk in the emergency room. Art was working that Thursday night when Stephanie failed to show up. It was supposed to be her last night at work, he said. She was moving to Texas the next week. I will take one more opportunity to lighten the mood a little bit. This is an earlier photo of Art and my dad from 1978. If you'll notice, Art is wearing a shirt that literally says "is." I remember this as a kid, Art and the "is" shirt. But looking closer at it, there were actually 10 other letters, those little felt letters that used to iron on in the 70s. This actually used to say Harrisburg, PA. So he somehow managed to wear 10 letters off that shirt and still wear it in public, which takes skill. I have no idea where he got the shirt, neither does he, because he never ventured out of the DC area. But oddly enough, Stephanie Watson, whom he'd meet 4 years after this photo, was from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Newspaper coverage expanded from the Laurel Leader to the Washington Post throughout July and August, with periodical columns noting that the hunt for the missing woman was ongoing. More often than not, Stephanie's name was misspelled in the Post, adding insult to injury. When the Leader reported that the shocking news of her partial remains being discovered on September 3rd, the headline proved that Laurel was on a first-name basis with this particular victim. With the news of a positive ID, an already dark cloud over Laurel took on an even more ominous hue. This was no longer a rescue mission for first responders, it was one of recovery. And worse, this was murder, one of, if not the most gruesome in this town's history. There were few clues, and when Stephanie's estranged husband, Wayne, was quickly and definitively ruled out as a suspect, there were no motives or suspects either. This fear was palpable for months, even as the case began to grow cold. The thought of someone loose out there capable of kidnapping and killing someone and then leaving only a skull in the woods, it was a scary time. Police were able to roughly reconstruct Stephanie's final hours on Thursday, July 22nd through interviews with coworkers and others who'd seen her, as well as family members who were expecting her that Friday, July 23rd. Using aerial maps and location photos, we can explore some of Stephanie's last known movements. We'll start with her house. Stephanie lived here at 304 8th Street, apartment 1. It's the ground floor apartment on the left. She lived alone here with her Siberian Husky, Keto, whom I'd later learned she used to fearlessly walk along the 8th Street fields early in the morning and late at night. I know this is difficult to read, but we're going to take a little trip through this map without the street names and landmarks. We'll do a virtual drive through Laurel, starting with Stephanie's apartment. This is the corner of 8th and Montgomery Streets. According to police reports, Stefanie was seen multiple times on Thursday, July 22nd, the first being at the hospital that afternoon when she picked up her paycheck. There's no way of knowing exactly what route she took, but this shows the proximity of her apartment on 8th Street to the hospital, taking 198 West to Van Dusen Road. She was scheduled to work later that Thursday night, which was to be her final shift before moving to Texas on Monday, July 26th, the day her car would be discovered instead. The hospital staff had thrown a going-away party for Stefanie on Wednesday, the night before, and she was supposed to meet her cousin Christy in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania on Friday. They were planning a long weekend in Ocean City before Stefanie's big move that coming Monday. Whether she went there directly from the hospital or not, another coworker reported seeing Stefanie later that afternoon at a bank in the Town Center Shopping Center at Conti Road and Route 197. This could have been either the Citizens Bank of Maryland on the corner near Conti Road exit, or John Hanson Savings and Loan, both of which were in the shopping center at the same time. This is a photo John Floyd took in 1984 of the Snow Country Inc. ski shop next door to the bank. I just thought that 8% is a pretty big number. And this is also a chance to throw in a little Lost Laurel stuff with the two banks. The last known sighting of Stefanie was shortly after 9 p.m. that night, as she was seen by a neighbor leaving her apartment. It's still unclear where she was going. She wasn't scheduled to report to work until 11:30. One of her former coworkers recently commented on my blog and revealed that Stefanie had been on the hospital's softball team, which had often convened for drinks at Max Place Plus One after their games. Max Place was a popular tavern at Laurel Shopping Center in the early 1980s that sponsored and hosted numerous teams. This is a leader photo from 1983. Microfilm is very tough to get good shots of. It was her recollection that the team was planning to meet that night at Max Place for a final dinner with Stefanie. It's a compelling thought given the location of Max Place, tucked in the corner of the shopping center next to Giant, beside what was at that time a dimly lit alleyway that exited to 4th Street. Max Place would have been right in here, and this was a walkway that came through. Literally a stone's throw away from the Middletown high-rise where Stefanie's car was found. Could this be the scene of the crime, or at least one of them? The only thing that seems to be clear is that whatever happened to Stefanie occurred that Thursday night after leaving her apartment at 9 o'clock and before she was due to report for her final hospital shift at 11:30. After 6 long weeks of speculation and angst, the worst fears of Stefanie Watson's relatives, friends, and all of Laurel were confirmed. On Friday, September 3rd, police discovered partial skeletal remains in the wooded area at the dead end of Larchdale Road. Initial reports stated that it was a citizen who made the grisly discovery, and on Tuesday, September 7th, the Maryland Medical Examiner's Office confirmed that the remains were indeed those of Stefanie Watson. Positive identification was made with dental records, according to then Laurel Police Lieutenant Archie Cook, who had headed the investigation to that point. He tactfully declined to elaborate on the physical condition of the remains, only to say that various television reports, likely about the partial skeletal remains being only the head, were unconfirmed. The discovery on Larchdale Road marked a transitional phase for the investigation, as Prince George's County Police essentially took over the case. The crime scene was determined to be in an area of Laurel under county police jurisdiction. Sergeant Sherman Baxa of the Prince George's County Homicide Unit credited Laurel Police for, quote, collecting a tremendous amount of data and for cooperating with the PG County detectives as they assumed the reins of the investigation. Sergeant Baxa later released some compelling information about the citizen who'd found the partial remains. He not only discovered them, he'd witnessed a man actually throwing them into the woods. Baxa stated that the wooded area at the end of Larchdale Road had been used as a dumping ground for debris for some time, but the witness who found the remains had, quote, observed an individual throwing something into the woods. He said that the witness became curious, later walked over to the wooded area, and subsequently made the startling discovery. The witness was never publicly identified for obvious safety and privacy concerns, nor was it made clear how he happened to be there to make the discovery. And while he couldn't positively identify the individual he'd seen dumping debris in the wooded area, he provided police with additional critical information. He'd seen the car the suspect emerged from, and he'd seen a second man inside. The car was reported to be a green 1975 to 78 Ford LTD with a green vinyl roof. A composite sketch was made and published in both the Laurel Leader and the Washington Post, citing a white male in his 40s, 6 feet tall, and weighing between 200 and 210 pounds. No one fitting the description was ever found, neither was the car. Despite substantial rewards offered by both Stephanie's parents and the Prince George's County crime solvers, none of the countless phone calls made from tipsters produced a viable lead, and the case went cold for the next 30 years. We'll fast forward to 2012. In the midst of curating this Lost Laurel thing, I realized that the 30th anniversary of Stephanie's death was approaching. I wanted to not only mark the occasion, but somehow generate interest and possibly even rejuvenate the investigation into her murder. I started by first trying to find any information online that I could about Stephanie or the case. Only one hit turned up. A footnote buried deep within an online amateur memorial page for Maryland homicide victims. And despite best intentions, it had both misspelled her name and stated the facts incorrectly. Sadly, that was all that seemed to be left of Stephanie Watson. Going back through back issue newspapers online, I was only able to find brief articles in the Washington Post and Baltimore Sun's archives, but a treasure trove came via the Laurel Leader on microfilm. There on the analog monochrome screen at the old Laurel Library was the full weekly saga from July to September 1982. All of these newspapers are now digitized at the Laurel Museum, by the way. Much better than microfilm, in every way. I was about to discover the Stephanie Watson case all over again, reading the details as they emerged that harrowing summer 30 years ago. I started to do some amateur sleuthing myself and went back to the place where I'd first heard the news back in 1982. I'm still in contact with a lot of old friends from Stewart Manor Apartments. In fact, we have a sort of Stewart Manor alumni group on Facebook and actually have reunions there every summer. I doubt many other apartment complexes can say they have former tenants who fly in from as far away as LA and Florida to reminisce with other former tenants, but that's just how it was growing up here for us. Anyway, I started asking my friends, including the older ones, what they remembered about the Stephanie Watson murder. Mark Nelson, one of the big kids who lived upstairs in my building at 100 Bryan Court, and who owned this sweet red Mustang at the time, said something that struck me as compelling, if not unlikely. I'd heard somebody say that the guy who killed Stephanie Watson was the same guy who killed Adam Walsh. The notion that the same man who'd murdered little Adam Walsh the previous year, all the way down in Hollywood, Florida, sounded like a long shot at best, until I started looking more closely at who that man actually was. And when comparing these new bits of information to those old Laurel Leader articles, I actually started to get chills. On July 27, 1981, almost exactly 1 year before Stephanie's murder, 6-year-old Adam Walsh was with his mother at the Sears store at their local Hollywood, Florida mall. Like any young boy in 1981, Adam was fascinated by an Atari video game display, being played by a small group of older kids. His mom, Revee Walsh, innocently left her son to briefly watch the gamers play while she inquired about a lamp just a few aisles away. In the 7 minutes she was gone, a Sears security guard responded to bickering amongst the kids by making them all exit the store, including little Adam, who instinctively followed the guard's orders and the other children and exited the nearest door. In that precise moment, Otis Toole was in the parking lot just looking for someone like Adam, and unfortunately he found him. Adam was allegedly lured into the stranger's borrowed Cadillac with promises of toys and candy. Toole, a deviant drifter who already convicted of a slew of bizarre and brutal crimes, confessed to abducting the boy with the intent of simply, quote, keeping him as his own. But when Adam began to cry and panic while driving north on I-95, Toole punched the boy into unconsciousness. Changing plans, he drove the car onto a deserted service road where he claimed to have strangled Adam to death before decapitating him with a machete he kept under the front seat. On August 10, 1981, a pair of fishermen discovered Adam's head in a Vero Beach, Florida canal. The rest of his remains have never been recovered, leading credence to Toole's claim that he incinerated the boy's body in an old refrigerator. Despite Toole's initial confession as early as 1983, Hollywood, Florida police bungled the investigation, inexplicably losing Toole's impounded car and the machete. It wasn't until nearly 25 years later, after an independent investigation by Detective Sergeant Joe Matthews at the behest of John and Revee Walsh, that police finally officially closed that case, naming Otis Toole as his murderer. While researching evidence files, Matthews had discovered rolls of film, photos taken by crime scene investigators and evidence technicians that had never even been developed. These photos, when processed, turned out to include chilling, detailed images of the missing Cadillac. One set of photos was particularly damning, as it documented a large presence of blood on the floorboard of the driver's seat and the carpet behind it, where Toole admitted to have callously tossed Adam's head before discarding it in the canal. An excerpt from Matthew's book reads, "Traced in the blue glow of luminol was the outline of a familiar young boy's face, a negative pressed into floorboard carpeting, eye sockets blackened black cavities, mouth twisted in an oval of pain." After an exhaustive review of the new evidence in 2008, Hollywood police posthumously charged Otis Toole, who died in prison in 1996 with the crime, and apologized to the Walsh family for the long, painful journey they had endured to that point. But there's much more to the Otis Toole story than just the murder of Adam Walsh, especially when it comes to his relationship with the even more notorious serial killer, Henry Lee Lucas. Henry Lee Lucas first met Otis Toole in line at a soup kitchen in Jacksonville, Florida in 1976. But before joining up with his frequent traveling partner, lover, and confidant, Lucas, a diagnosed psychopath, had already killed before. His first murder in 1960 was that of his own mother. Beginning in 1978, Lucas and Toole embarked on a series of cross-country murder sprees. Lucas would later claim that during this period he had killed hundreds of people, with Toole assisting him in, quote, 108 murders by his estimation. Lucas stated that his preferred victims were young white females. Toole preferred men. Their methods of murder included everything from stabbing, shooting, strangulation, and beatings to mutilations, with Lucas having been known to decapitate victims and carry body parts with him across state lines on different occasions. When traveling together, Lucas and Toole were virtually untraceable, making erratic treks from coast to coast. Lucas, on record, later confirmed to Texas prosecutors that in September 1982 alone, the pair had been through Missouri, Indiana, Illinois, Oklahoma, and here in Maryland. Criminal profilers in various states found themselves stumped at the lack of motive and pattern in some particularly brutal crimes, as was certainly the case with the Stefanie Watson murder. Serial killers, it was commonly believed, usually work alone. The utter randomness of these crimes was virtually unprecedented, especially when they occurred in small communities. The two would occasionally separate, committing crimes on their own before reuniting. It was during one such separation that Otis Toole murdered Adam Walsh. Lucas was arrested in Texas in June of 1983 and almost immediately began confessing to scores of other murders, including many that he couldn't possibly have committed. Enjoying the extra attention warranted someone who boasts of having killed hundreds, even thousands of people, Lucas seemingly began copping to any and all unsolved cases presented to him. He would then recant confessions just as frequently, further baffling prosecutors. In November 1983, the Lucas Task Force was created for the purpose of coordinating with police agencies across the country. So vast and wide were Henry's claims that Texas authorities gave out-of-state cold case detectives the opportunity to interview Lucas for their own cases. One of those agencies, I learned, was Prince George's County Homicide. The Lucas Task Force was well underway in 1984 when it began to receive criticism for becoming, quote, a veritable clearinghouse of unsolved murder. In fact, police officially cleared 213 previously unsolved murders via Lucas's confessions. It was at this time that Vic Fiesel, an ambitious young district attorney in Waco, Texas, launched a large-scale investigation into the veracity of Lucas's confessions. The result was the Lucas Report, an extensive timeline documenting the confirmed travel movements of Henry Lee Lucas and Otis Toole that conclusively disproved many of Lucas's confessions. In a typical instance, the report showed Lucas cashing checks in Florida while at the same time confessing to a murder in Texas. But in reviewing these documents online, it was Fiesel's timeline that caught my attention and actually convinced me that Lucas and Toole might very well have been responsible for one of the few murders they didn't confess to, Stefanie Watson's. Fiesel's timeline showed no record of Lucas's whereabouts during July 1982, the time when Stefanie was killed. It did, however, document several of Lucas's travels throughout Maryland. The report included grim information about Lucas's methods, which clearly matched the Stefanie Watson murder profile. But what struck me most was an innocuous line item about a vehicle purchase in January 1982. According to multiple entries in Vic Fiesel's notes, Lucas purchased a 1973 Ford LTD on January 9, 1982. It stated that the car was brown, but that did little to diminish the adrenaline rush I suddenly felt at that moment. What are the odds, I thought. What are the odds that someone witnessed two men in a 1970s Model Ford LTD tossing a partial skull into the woods at the dead end of Larchdale Road? Two documented serial killers, erratic drifters, both of whom had connections to Prince George's County, the opportunity, the means, and certainly the will to commit this type of crime. They'd been free at the time of Stephanie's disappearance, confirmed having traveled through Maryland in the summer of 1982, and were driving a 1973 Ford LTD at the time. I thought, what are the odds that it wasn't Henry Lee Lucas and Otis Toole who killed Stephanie Watson? Could it really have just been some amazing coincidence, and that two other guys, one of whom eerily fit the description of Otis Toole, based on that composite sketch, just happened to be driving an equally similar Ford LTD and tossed a severed head into a wooded area? Could there really have been anyone else even capable of such a horrific crime, not to mention the numerous coincidences? I started to feel like I dropped into an episode of The First 48 or America's Most Wanted or something. Here I was, piecing together a far-fetched cold case theory that suddenly sounded extremely plausible, to me at least. Next, I put in a call into the Laurel Police Department, hoping to get any information I could about the case and to talk about what I'd found and was planning to write about. I found myself on the phone talking to none other than Chief of Police Rich McLaughlin. It was at this point that I got a little nervous, and I made sure to let him know that I was only 9 years old at the time of the crime, so he wouldn't start thinking I was the killer checking up 30 years later. He remembered that summer of 1982, even though it was years before his time on the force. He explained that predictably all of the investigators from that time had since retired, and that PG County had almost immediately taken over the investigation once the remains were found due to jurisdiction. But he encouraged me to call PG County Homicide and ask for the cold case unit. He gave me the number and even told me what to say when I called so I wouldn't be even more nervous. Over the next week, I spoke to Sergeant Rick Fulginetti and Detective David Morissette, both of Prince George's County Homicide. Sergeant Fulginetti confirmed that the case was indeed still open and active. And when Detective Morissette began explaining just a few of the general points that their cold case unit had been investigating, I immediately realized that I hadn't uncovered anything that Prince George's County detectives didn't already know. Go figure. In fact, the very first name Detective Morissette mentioned was Henry Lee Lucas. He confirmed that in 1984, Prince George's County had indeed sent a team of investigators to Texas to participate in the Lucas Task Force questioning. While their suspicions had always lied with Lucas, they simply weren't able to conclusively connect him to the crime. Apparently, their visit occurred during a rare moment when Lucas wasn't in a confessing mood. Wanting to make sure I wouldn't only be spreading more rumors and misinformation about the tragedy, I essentially sought an off-the-record endorsement for the conclusion that I'd surprisingly come to on my own. Detective Morissette simply encouraged me to write the piece exactly as I'd planned, adding that it could even jog some long-suppressed memories or prompt someone to finally come forward with details that they just weren't ready to share over the past three decades. So on August 7th, 2012, having no idea how it would be received by the nostalgic Lost Laurel public, I posted the article, to my knowledge, the first lengthy piece written about Stephanie Watson and this case in three decades. Within days, it generated more comments than any of my other blog posts, and the link to the article on Facebook was even more. I heard from so many different people who shared equally vivid memories of this crime. I heard from a few people who had theories of their own. I heard from a few of Stephanie's former co-workers at the hospital. I heard from one of her neighbors. And most surprising of all, I even heard from Stephanie's family. I had actually considered trying to contact Stephanie's family before I even started writing, but the fear of opening old wounds for them was great, and being neither a professional journalist or investigator, I just didn't feel comfortable doing that. Talking to Chief McLaughlin and Sergeant Fulginetti reassured me that what I was writing wouldn't impede the investigation, nor should it upset Stephanie's family should they happen to come across it, which was my concern. And amazingly, that October, I received an email from Stephanie's cousin, Leanne Cashman. She explained that her older sister, Christy, had been Stephanie's best friend. In fact, Chris was the one who reported her missing that Friday in 1982 when Stephanie didn't show up. Leanne shared some wonderful memories of their cousin and thanked me for the time I'd put into writing about her. If the story had ended right there, I would have been happy that I'd done a small good deed in just bringing Stephanie's memory back to the public's consciousness, but it didn't end there. The blog posting continued to generate comments over the next several months, and Leanne and I kept in touch into 2013. Then on Friday, June 21st, I got an email from her that I never could have expected. She was letting me know that there had been an arrest in Stephanie's murder, and that the DNA actually matched an inmate named John Walsh. I'm not kidding, she added. My first thought was, John Walsh? This guy? It turned out to be this guy, John Ernest Walsh, a now 70-year-old inmate who's been incarcerated on an unrelated charge since 1989. Walsh, we learned, had been arrested in 1969 when he was only 24 years old for the kidnapping, rape, and attempted murder of a woman in Prince George's County whose throat and wrists he cut before literally leaving her for dead in the woods. Against all odds, she survived, and Walsh was sentenced to 72 years in prison. But unfortunately for society, this was just the beginning of his story. Walsh was considered a psychiatric patient and was handpicked by the notorious Patuxent Institution in Jessup for rehabilitation. After serving only 8 years, he was deemed rehabilitated, at least enough to be allowed out on work release. That was in 1978. 2 years later, in 1980, he was paroled outright. You heard that correctly. This man kidnapped, raped, and cut a woman's throat, then ended up really only serving 8 years of a 72-year sentence. And so it came to be that on July 22, 1982, John Ernest Walsh, the rehabilitated kidnapper, rapist, murderer, fatefully crossed paths with Stefanie Watson. Having had his parole revoked in 1989 for failing a drug test, Walsh has spent the last 26 years at Eastern Correctional Institution, where he's inmate number 113067. Preserved DNA from the back of the driver's seat of Stephanie's blood-soaked 1981 Chevette unequivocally matched that of Walsh. Stephanie, it's clear, put up an incredible fight in that small car, as a significant amount of that blood evidently belonged to Walsh, whose face still bears distinct scars. I learned all of this in dramatic fashion on Sunday, June 23rd, when I got a call from Sergeant Fulginiti confirming the stunning news I'd first heard from Leanne. "I've spoken to Stephanie's family and I wanted to call you next," he said. And in what was a tremendous honor, he told me that the Lost Laurel article had indeed helped breathe new life into the cold case. He held a press conference on Tuesday, June 25th, and for the first time since this unspeakable crime occurred back in the summer of 1982, there was no shortage of news coverage. The Laurel Leader, rightfully, was one of the first to break the story. Watching the press conference, I realized something. The photo of Stephanie was the first color photo of her I can remember seeing. It was taken from her driver's license and had been in the police file. Seeing her in full color, it was almost as if she'd reemerged from this 30-year nightmare, having been hidden in some murky black and white mystery for an entire generation. I knew I'd have to write a follow-up to the blog post sharing the stunning news of the arrest, but I had the idea that this should really be more about Stephanie herself and not the man who killed her. I talked to Leanne about possibly using some family photos and learning more about who Stephanie actually was, the music she liked, the TV shows she watched, things that would finally humanize her for this community that had only known her from the missing persons flyer. Leanne put me in touch with her older sister, Christy Torres, who had been Stephanie's best friend. The first time I talked to Chris on the phone, we ended up talking about Stephanie for close to 2 hours, and I came away feeling like I genuinely knew both of them. When I told her how the color photo of Stephanie was such a breath of fresh air, she laughed and said, "That's actually not even a very good photo of her. There are so many better ones, I'll show you." And she did indeed. But before we get to those and find out a little bit about who Stephanie was, there's another amazing story to come out of this, one that's never been told. Among the folks who've contacted me after the break in the case is a junior high social studies teacher from Mesa, Arizona. Todd McKeevers has been teaching high school and junior high students about social studies, US history, political science, and business education in Arizona for the past 20 years. He's also a popular basketball and baseball coach. Back in 1982, Todd was a junior at St. Vincent Pilate here in Laurel. And on September 3rd, he was the one person who witnessed John Ernest Walsh drive his Ford LTD to the dead end of Larchdale Road and toss something into the woods. Moments later, Todd McKeevers discovered the partial remains of Stephanie Watson. He was working as a groundskeeper for Larchdale Woods Apartments, now known as Park Laurel, of which his father was the property manager. It was Todd's job to oversee the overflow of trash and other general groundskeeping duties. And he had his work cut out for him, as the dead end of Larchdale Road was notorious for trash dumping. In fact, to this day, measures are taken to prevent people from dumping trash and other debris in the woods near the swimming pool. Large dumpsters still line the road, just as they did when Todd worked there. He recalls a particularly large one that the apartment complex used for discarding old appliances that were being replaced that summer. With his dad being the property manager, Todd's family lived in this house, adjacent to the dead end on the opposite side. Their house technically sat at the dead end of North Point Lane. 30 years ago, the dead zone between North Point Lane and Larchdale Road, the space between Todd's house and the swimming pool, was considerably less overgrown than it is today, as you'll see in these aerial photos from 1980. This is Todd's house, swimming pool, the loop to the pool, and Larchdale Road. I emailed the image to Todd and asked if he could annotate exactly what he saw that day. What he sent me is this chilling step-by-step recounting of where he was, where Walsh discarded the remains, and why his family was so terrorized by the encounter. They moved to Reno, Nevada, 3 days after Todd graduated the following spring. Let's walk through this recap step-by-step. Todd was just coming home from school that afternoon, driving north on North Point Lane toward his house at the dead end of the street, the other side of which was the dead end of Larchdale Road. I didn't ask Todd what kind of car he drove or what color, but I'm going to use a blue one just for the sake of this. At that exact moment, Walsh's green Ford LTD was pulling into the dead end turn on Larchdale. Todd noticed that there were two men inside. As he did every day, Todd pulled into his driveway and then backed out, parallel parking along the curb. As he's backing up, he notices that the green Ford has stopped near the swimming pool and the driver has exited the vehicle. Todd notices that the man is wearing a yellow dishwashing glove on his right hand. He sees the man open the rear driver's side door and reach into the back behind the seat on the floor. Having grabbed what he wanted, he shut the door and then walked behind the vehicle. Here, within just a few feet of his car, he tossed something into the woods to the right of the pool area. Todd's first thought was, nobody throws trash on my property, as it was literally his job to maintain this area. But he had a sense that there was something particularly odd about this. He chose to take his time and wait in the car so as not to draw more attention to himself. The green Ford eventually drove off, heading north on Larchdale Road toward Conti Road, driving no faster than any other car on a given day. Not knowing where the car actually went as it drove up Larchdale through the complex, Todd decided to take the family dog before heading out to investigate. I actually found a little dog. Pretending to walk the dog, Todd worked his way around the dead end to the Larchdale side, where he'd seen the man clearly discard something. What he found wasn't deep into the woods at all, just a step beyond the initial brush. Contrary to other reports, it also wasn't in a bag of any kind. Not knowing what he was actually seeing, Todd gently used the tip of his shoe to get a closer look. That's when he saw enough to immediately realize that this was likely partial human remains. Todd quickly took the dog back home and sprinted to the maintenance shop on the Larchdale Woods property. With his dad out of town on business, he needed to find the maintenance supervisor who was like an older brother to him. When he arrived, the whole crew was there and the supervisor knew something was wrong just by the look on Todd's face. He describes that moment as being very much like the movie Stand By Me, which was still a few years away. As he told them, I think I found pieces of a dead person. Some of the guys were like, yeah, right, but they all jumped into a truck and proceeded down to the wooded area beside the pool. Not knowing exactly what they should do when they got there, one of the men decided he would take a closer look and gently lifted the remains with a small stick. He noticed the fillings in the teeth and said, this definitely isn't an animal. Just as they were about to call the police, an officer who happened to live in the neighborhood was on his way home. They flagged him down, and Todd gave the only description of the car and the man that would appear in the subsequent news reports. With his dad out of town and working on a new site in Reno, Todd's mother bought a Doberman for an added sense of security. Living in such a secluded area, she also requested police assistance, believing it was impossible that the suspect wouldn't immediately know that it was Todd who'd been the witness, and he knew where they lived. It was for this reason that Todd's name was never released. The best they could get was a police car parked at the dead end near where the remains were found. Todd eventually graduated in June of 83 and moved to Reno 3 days afterwards. He was contacted in 1987 and asked to come in and look at the photos, but nothing came to him as a positive ID, likely because John Ernest Walsh was never on anyone's radar for this crime until his blood DNA turned up in Stephanie's car 30 years later. I talk about the countless coincidences that just seem to keep coming up in this case. Did you notice anyone else on that page from Todd's yearbook? Right next to him, in fact, it's Laurel Police Chief Rich McLaughlin. I have a feeling I'm going to find a ticket on my car when I go out there tonight. We hear all the time about random, senseless killings, and we search and try to find answers for things that really are just that, random and senseless. It's in our nature to deny things, like the idea that someone as insignificant as a crazy lone gunman can assassinate a president. Surely it's a larger conspiracy or something, right? For 33 years, we've wondered what exactly happened to Stefanie Watson. We may never know the full story, but the picture is finally becoming a bit clearer. The main question, who did it, has been answered. And John Ernest Walsh, the insignificant lone degenerate who randomly crossed her path and took her life, is finally scheduled to go on trial for first-degree murder next month. The unlikely coincidences that permeate this tragic chapter in Laurel's history never cease to amaze me. The sheer randomness of the crime, the timing of Stephanie's last night at work and plans to relocate, the similarities between her murder and that of Adam Walsh, and now the very name of her killer. As they say, you can't make this stuff up. Nonetheless, it happened, and those of us who lived in Laurel during the summer of 1982 have never forgotten, nor will we ever. Laurel just celebrated another 4th of July, one that would have been Stephanie's 60th. It's time we remember Stephanie as more than just a victim. She was born Stephanie Sue Wilbert in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania on July 3rd, 1955. Stephanie's niece, Kate, who had only been 3 months old at the time of her aunt's disappearance, shared these wonderful photos of Stephanie through the years. This is Stephanie with her older sister, Peg. She graduated from Central Dauphin East High School in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania in 1973. A side note about these yearbook photos, I actually had to sign up on classmates.com or whatever it is as a member of the Central Dauphin East High School class of 73 to access them, and the Pilates class of 83. As a result, I occasionally get invited to their class reunions, and I don't have the heart to tell them that I was born a year before they graduated. In her junior yearbook, they'd misspelled her name with a PH. Her expression here seems to suggest that she was already starting to get tired of people misspelling her name. Stephanie would go on to attend Harrisburg Community College. She came to the Washington, D.C. area to attend Columbia Union College, now Washington Adventist University, in Tacoma Park in September 1981, and settled in Laurel after a brief marriage to Wayne Watson ended in separation. Stephanie held a number of jobs, working as a clerical typist in a dentist office prior to becoming the night admitting clerk in the busy emergency room at Greater Laurel Beltsville Hospital, a job that she rightly considered much more than simply filling out insurance forms. Colleagues recalled that she never failed to console families of the sick and injured, bringing them coffee and allowing them a chance to talk about their anxiety and grief. One staff doctor noted the countless cases of, quote, gratuitous and senseless violence that the emergency room saw on any given night shift, and that Stephanie was always, quote, caring and concerned for all the people she met, ingenious and never cynical, even when patients or their families seemed undeserving of her patience and thoughtfulness. The Laurel that Stephanie came to in 1981 was experiencing a renaissance of sorts. The recent opening of Laurel Center Mall, the newly restored Main Street, and the advent of the annual Main Street Festival. Here, Stephanie found a place to heal the wounds of her broken relationship and begin anew. She lived alone with Keto at the small apartment on 8th Street, a short drive from her job at the hospital. She had a wicked sense of humor, her cousin Chris mused, and she loved the beach. To that point, Deborah Moore, an 18-year-old neighbor who lived in the building beside Stephanie's in 1982, even remembers her sunbathing on the 8th Street fields right in front of her apartment. She was fearless, Chris reiterated. She would walk Keto along those fields early in the morning and late at night. Stephanie was only 2 years older than Chris, an obvious factor in their closeness. Her sister, Margaret, known as Peg, while undoubtedly close herself, was 7 years older than Stephanie. But Stephanie and Chris were, by all accounts, inseparable best friends. Speaking to Chris about Stephanie all these years later, the joy in her voice is palpable, as are the memories. Oh, she was a good time, just a really good time, Chris's little sister, Leanne, commented on this photo in particular. "That's more Stephanie than most of the other pictures," Leanne said, finally recalling her cool cousin. "I look at her face and still see the girl that I thought was so pretty and had great clothes. I would sneak them out of her bag when she spent the night, wear them to school, and have them nicely folded and back in her bag before she and my sister got home from work. They were older than me. Chris is 4 years older and Stephanie was 6 years older. Chris always thought of me as her pesky little sister and would tell me to get lost, and Stephanie would tell her to stop being so mean. Chris also attested to Stephanie's fashion sense and how she was always super neat and had to make sure everything was clean and pressed. I asked about Stephanie's favorite foods, and with a laugh, Chris explained that Stephanie, quote, could eat like a hog and never gain weight. She added that they would often eat frequently and at odd times, undoubtedly due in part to Stephanie's late work schedule at the hospital. Chris thought about the restaurants they frequented together in Laurel, and one name came instantly to mind, Tippy's Taco House, she said, knowing that it's still open at 315 Gorman Avenue, albeit under the name Toucan Taco since 1992. The girls would get their Tex-Mex fix, and Chris would even buy more for the trip home to Pennsylvania. We talked about the TV shows that Stephanie watched, too. I remember she loved Tom Selleck and Magnum P.I., Happy Days, Laverne and Shirley, One Day at a Time, The Love Boat, Saturday Night Live, when Saturday Night Live was good, of course. Music was a big part of Stephanie's life, and she and Chris often frequented concerts, including several at Meriwether Post Pavilion in nearby Columbia. We'd go to any concert, she said. It really didn't matter who was playing. We just loved to go. She cited a number of Stephanie's favorite recording artists, and while the list paints a veritable time capsule of the era, it also attests to her diverse taste in music. Rod Stewart, I expected. Charlie Daniels, I did not. But Chris said they were both part of Stephanie's playlist. The Bee Gees, Blondie, Rod Stewart, Charlie Daniels, Marshall Tucker, Christopher Cross, Elton John, David Bowie, Todd Rundgren, and her all-time favorite, Dan Fogelberg, loved him. She was also a huge Steely Dan fan. A few years earlier in Pennsylvania, she'd also had another dog named Jackson, because she also loved Jackson Brown. It's easy for us to use terms like playlist today and forget that it wouldn't have been part of Stephanie's lexicon 30 plus years ago. Chris and I talked about this as well, how there were no cell phones, no internet, no MP3s, none of the modern conveniences that we take for granted today. Consider the things that Stephanie missed out on in just that first year alone. Michael Jackson's Thriller, Return of the Jedi, A Christmas Story, Friday Night Videos, Flashdance, Madonna. Then consider everything she missed over the next 30 years. It's staggering. Stephanie would have just celebrated her 60th birthday on July 3rd, and it's hard to fathom that she's now been gone much longer than she was here. This is especially true for Laurel, where she was really only a resident for a total of 10 months. Even if the unspeakable hadn't occurred, she was literally just days away from relocating to Fort Worth, Texas. I posted this image on the Lost Laurel Facebook page the other day. Laurel's 4th of July celebration in 1982 fell on July 3rd that year, which happened to be her 27th and final birthday. She'd go missing less than 3 weeks later. This banner, coincidentally, was directly across the street from her apartment on 8th Street. I'm 42 years old today. That doesn't sound good. That's 15 years older than Stephanie was at the time of her disappearance. And it's amazing how time flies by. And while the rest of us continue to get older and live our lives, Stephanie will always remain that beautiful and kind 27-year-old who loved the beach, her dog, and concerts. And she'll forever be a part of Laurel. I like to think that had she lived, she would even be an active Lost Laurel follower on Facebook, reminiscing over photos and artifacts she'd finally recall from her time in our hometown. Like anything from Tippy's Tacos. I never would have dreamed as a little kid nearly 33 years ago that I'd grow up and contribute a small part to the finally catching the man responsible for Stephanie Watson's murder. I've had several people congratulate me for supposedly solving the case, but that's not what happened. All I really did was talk about it and get other people talking about it. Yes, I had an interesting theory about what might have happened, but that turned out to be wrong. I'll give you an analogy. Some friends and I used to play in a weekend warrior football league up until recently. I mentioned I'm getting old. There was one particular play where our QB threw an interception, and it was a freak play. The guy who caught the ball was way out of position, and it just happened to land right in his hands. And our quarterback, Eric, blew it off and took a jab at the other team at the same time. He said, "It's okay, he got the interception by playing bad defense." We all laughed, but the bottom line was they ended up with the ball, and that was the main thing. that's kind of how I see my part in all of this. My article and theory about Stefanie Watson's case was a lot like that guy's bad defense, but it got the ball back, so to speak. And those amazing Prince George's County cold case detectives were able to take it and score. That's what matters. There are still plenty of questions, and hopefully the trial will provide more answers. Stefanie's complete remains have never been recovered. She's yet to receive a proper burial or a permanent resting place. There was a memorial service for her, however, shortly after the identification was made. According to Pastor Arthur Mayer, almost 100 people filled the small Seventh-day Adventist church in Laurel that September afternoon. And there would have been more. Originally scheduled for 7 p.m., Stefanie's family decided at the last moment to change the time to early afternoon so her coworkers from the hospital night shift could attend. For many, including the press, news of the change in time came too late. The hospital also honored Stefanie's memory with a brief but moving service attended by almost 60 members of the medical staff, plus friends and family. In a fitting tribute to the young woman who'd comforted so many worried patients there, the family room of the Greater Laurel Beltsville Hospital's emergency room was officially dedicated to Stefanie Watson. The hospital has changed a great deal since Stefanie's time there, though. It's undergone a number of changes and expansions in the years since, including an entirely new emergency room wing. I stopped by a few weeks ago for the first time since God knows when and barely recognized it. I had hoped to get a photo of a plaque or something in the waiting room with Stefanie's name on it, something that I could show in this presentation tonight. Unfortunately, but not surprisingly, I didn't have any luck finding that. A kind older lady at the registration desk who's been there since the late 1980s remembered hearing about Stefanie Watson, but couldn't recall seeing any plaques in her memory in either the old or the new wing. That didn't stop her from helping me hunt for it, though. I ended up getting a full-blown tour of the emergency room, which was awesome. One of my friends here, Pete Lunas, in his inimitable way, made what I thought was a great suggestion when he knew that I was having trouble finding that plaque. Call the hospital's board of directors. Tell them you'll design it. Have Dottie's trophies created and get her name back in there where it belongs. So that's what I plan to do. I'll talk to Stefanie's family about it first and then talk to the hospital's board of directors about what it should say and how we can make that happen. Every time I hear this song by Elton John, which we now know was one of Stefanie's favorites, that line, I think, sums up my feelings and probably everybody from my generation who remembered this incident. It's been over 30 years, but hopefully we all feel like we know Stefanie a little bit now, too. Thank you again. I know I was surprised tonight. I didn't expect this, and I won't put her on the spot, but I got to meet Christy Torres tonight, who drove from Pennsylvania. This is Stefanie's cousin and best friend. I want another one.
Great job.
Thank you.
I had asked Prince George's County Police if they wanted to have someone here to take any questions. Unfortunately, because the case is ongoing, the trial is tentatively scheduled for August 24th, I believe. But the detective thought that would probably get pushed back even further. But they're not allowed to speak. He did clear that everything I was going to say tonight was fine. But I can take some questions and hopefully answer if anyone has anything. Yes, he's been in prison since 1989. He failed a drug test, and that's how his parole was revoked. So he's been incarcerated all these years, but not for Stefanie's murder. He was just formally charged within the past year. I can only begin to imagine how many cold cases they have. I'm sure even Laurel has several, you know, that go back years, so something as big as countywide. But just talking to them, and I think Sergeant Fulginitti was intrigued by the fact that we were talking about it 30 years later and nothing had been written, and he remembered it. And it was enough to say, sort of like when you remember something and you're like, I'm going to go dig that book out again, or I'm going to dig that DVD out. He went and got it and looked to see what they had. I think they were probably planning all along for DNA evidence, you know, for any cold case. But my understanding was that they had preserved the entire driver's seat from her car in storage somehow, or at least a portion.
That's the amazing part.
Yeah.
That they had the DNA.
Yes. That they thought to preserve that before the technology existed. Yep.
Would the other man in the car have identified
it? No. And that's the biggest question I have, too, is who was this other man? And, you know, the fact that what he threw in the woods had no wasn't in a bag or anything, you know, surely this guy would have questioned, what is it, what are you throwing there? You know, who was it? Where is he today? That's something that hopefully will come out at trial. But the fact that, you know, this man's blood was in that car and there was no connections to her whatsoever is, you know, definitive proof that he was the one responsible. I'm sorry?
The dog.
Uh-huh.
Did they find the dog in her apartment?
Yes. And I believe, Chris, did you pick up Keto?
Yeah, I had.
Okay. And that was part of the reason, I think, why you reported her missing, was you knew, or the...
She didn't show up to go to the beach, and I called friends of hers down here, and they were going to the apartment. Well, they called her, and when they didn't show up to work, they got into the apartment.
Right. Because they knew she wasn't going to leave with the dog still at the apartment. Anything else?
Did the guy confess to it after he was caught charged, or was he?
No, not yet. And Sergeant Fulginiti said that, you know, he's talked to him several times, and the initial reaction was, I don't remember, which could very well be true. But he was able to talk to him in the manner that detectives do, I'm sure, reminiscing. You being a car guy will appreciate this. He just happened to start talking about 1970s Ford LTDs, and this guy copped to it. He's like, oh yeah, I had a green one. So again, it's like, keep it coming, because, you know, this is the stuff that we'll use. Mm-hmm.
Does this guy have a public defender, or does he have a
public defender? It seems that it'll be public defender. I'm only going by a site that Chief McLaughlin referred me to. It's a Maryland Judiciary case search site where you can kind of keep tabs on cases, and it gives like an up-to-date log of everything that's going on. And I did see public defender. I don't know if he'll stick with it, but that's what my understanding is.
Are you going to go public case?
Am I going to go?
Trial.
Chris asked if I would, and I would certainly like to sit with them. Uh huh. What did we say? It was 78 and then paroled in 80. So, I mean, he had been out. And I think that's something that PG County is looking into, is that the belief that she probably isn't the only victim here. He was out for a significant amount of time, and then he wasn't put back in until 89. So, you know, that's a good chunk of time for somebody like this to be on the streets.
It's crazy that they released him.
Yeah. And that's, you know, a knock against that Patuxent institution.
Did they know where he was in the fall of 1980?
I haven't looked to that. That would be a question for them. I'm sure they're trying to cover his tracks, you know, from the entire time that he was out.
His daughter was kidnapped, raped, and murdered in Texas in the fall of 1980 by walking on the campus of Texas A&M College.
Mm-hmm. It's like I said, so many coincidences.
But they did find the person who killed her.
Mm-hmm.
19 years later, they finally executed him, almost as long as she lived.
Right.
He killed her 2 weeks before her 20th birthday.
Mm.
I was just wondering if that was one of the murders he confessed to.
To my knowledge, he hasn't confessed to anything.
No, I think she's referring to
Lucas. Oh. Oh, yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. And both of those guys, Lucas and Toole, have both died in prison. And both actually weren't free long after. I think 83 was the last year that either of those guys were out.
Huh. So it was always in my mind that the same man was with him.
Right. Well, like I said, I mean, hopefully someone talks to him and coaxes something out of him. As they say, I mean, we can't bring her back. Nothing will ever do that. But I remember asking Chris when we started, I said, is there anything, does this dredge up, are the memories too painful for this? Or when the trial actually happens, is there anything, you know, will you want to be there? And she was right away, you were like, oh, I wouldn't miss it for the world. And she said, there's nothing that he can say that would be more painful than what we've already been through. And I thought that was one of the strongest things I've heard.
Yeah? He failed the drug test, and he's in prison all
those years. Well, he had been in prison, and he was being rehabilitated. And then one of his, you know, when you're out, you have to come back and report for drug testing, and he failed it. I don't know what the drug was.
But the irony of that.
Yeah. That is what kept him in prison for the last 26 years, is just that. And, of course, he's been appealing that. Or he was, I don't have it here. I didn't want to stretch this out too far. But one of the things that I thought was appalling, it's on the record that he had written for these appeals, like he didn't want to go back to the real prison. He wanted to go to the cushy Patuxent institution, you know, where everything was much more lax and he was familiar with it. And he felt he was being wrongly imprisoned, you know, because he failed this drug test. So I'm sure we would have loved to have seen the expression on his face when this charge came calling.
But wasn't his sentence for 72
years? Yes. And that was for attempted murder, because the woman survived.
So, in fact, she wasn't illegally in prison.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, the connection to Laurel was easy, but for
sure. From what I've heard, he wasn't actually living in Laurel. He worked somewhere near Savage. I'm not sure what he did exactly, but he knew the area, and he came through. And that's, you know, we could speculate, you know, forever. Like, how did he, I still have it in my mind, it's like, well, where did he actually see her? Did he see her coming out of her apartment? Did he see her at the bank? You know, did he stalk her? We don't know. Was he driving by down 8th Street when she was out sunbathing, as a neighbor said, you know, and start that way? Only he knows that for sure. But from what every connection they could find, it was totally random. She never met him. There were no connections. There were no shared friends or acquaintances. There was talk about some of her coworkers lived in the Middletown apartments, high rise, and they thought, you know, is that why her car is there? Again, so many questions. You know, how did the car end up there? Where had the car been? It had obviously been driven off road, but only he knows for sure.
Where was he from?
That I don't know. I'm not sure where he was born. He was born in 1945, but from this area, and only, you know, I believe the first arrest was when he was 24 years old. There may have been priors to that, but that's as far as I could go back.
From what I was told, he was adopted. He was a little bit of a child, but they said the entire time he's been in prison, there's never been contact with him.
You know, you guys would know, Chris, did they ever contact you, America's Most Wanted, years ago? I've never seen it.
Seems like that would have been fine.
Right, and like I said, I mean, that's what...
And the irony, well...
Yeah. I did get an email not too long ago from a producer for... Actually, Donnie would remember. I was just talking to him before we got here. Paul Azan's Investigation Discovery. And I think they're interested, but only after the trial, you know, when they can tie it up, all the loose ends. But it just, so many things, it just reads like a Hollywood murder mystery, you know, and the fact that nothing had been said all these years, even here. It just, Karen?
How would they have been able to get
That's what I mean, is he had to have been familiar. You know, there were no GPSs back then. For him to know that that dead end, you know, there's a, and he drove it like he knew it. Maybe he had lived there at some point. I just haven't seen that information.
Thank you.
Are we done? Thank you, guys.
Goodbye, Norma Jean. Though I never knew at all, you had the grace to hold yourself and those around you call. You crawled out of the woodwork and they whispered into your brain. They said you are the treadmill and they made you change your name. It seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind, never knowing who to cling to when the rain set in. I would have liked to have known you, but I was just a kid. Your candle burned out long before your legend ever did.